In this video, I'll show you how to create a custom CRM system that can be built to perfectly fit any business, includes workflow automation, integrates with third-party invoicing systems, updates an ERP system, runs over your database, and much more, all in less time than it would take to deploy an out-of-the-box solution. I'll do this all in about an hour and 15 minutes using low-code software, and if you're at all considering a custom CRM, low-code tools are perfectly suited for this type of project. They can deliver something that's custom-built to your needs with all the features you'll need in a CRM, and they'll make it fast. You can create one in days with the right tool. And they can save money since you can roll out a custom CRM to your entire business without paying user fees. Before we build it, I want to show you what we're building. I'll walk you through a demo here, but first let me start off with a bird's eye view of the system. I'll be starting with three main database tables: contacts, companies, and deals. I have a few smaller tables that'll tie into these main tables, like notes and salespeople, but the main work will be over these three tables. So over each table, I'm building database front ends to view and edit this data. I'll also create nice single view applications for individual contacts and companies and include some useful information like notes and even deals on the company screen. And of course, I'll link all of this together so users can easily navigate and tie everything together with the home screen. Now, the really powerful part comes into play with the deals. We have some custom workflow elements in the form of a customer onboarding process. When a new deal is submitted, the system will generate a contract and send that to the customer. When that is signed, it will send the customer info to our payment processing software, Stripe. And finally, when the invoice is paid, it will update our ERP system and notify the salesperson. Now, that's just a high-level view. Let's dive in and take a quick look at the CRM system we're building. And one thing to note, I've included a link to this CRM demo below the video if you'd like to play around with it on your own. Okay, let's check out what we're building. This is for a fictional consulting company, but you could build a CRM with this approach for really any company type. Here's the home screen of our CRM system, and keep in mind, this is all custom. So as I go through it, just remember, it can be designed and created however you wish. The home screen is fairly straightforward. It provides important analytics at a glance up here, and also has all of my data down here in tabs. All of this gives a quick overview of the CRM and provides simple navigation to whatever data you might want to see, like contacts, companies, or deals. So, let's say that I want to view one of my contacts here. I'm taken to the contact view where I have the contact information here on the left and notes and a meeting calendar here on the right. Now let's say that I've spoken to this person. I can add notes about that conversation over here. Once I save that note, it appears on the contact page. Okay, so let's look at the company this contact works for. The company view is similar to the contact page with the information on the left, only here we have this nice badge to indicate status so the user will instantly know if they're a lead or a customer. Again, I can edit or remove this company and even add notes at the company level here. The difference here is that I have my data in tabs where I can manage deals for this customer and view all the contacts in this company. I also have these nice stat widgets up here at the top to give a quick overview of this customer's revenue and unpaid contracts. Now, the really nice part about this page is something that's not immediately obvious. If I were to add a new deal, it would set off that customer onboarding workflow that I explained earlier with this diagram. I'll demonstrate it after we build the CRM, but not right now. All right, so that's the basics of the CRM system that we're going to build. Actually, one more thing. I have more options up here where I can see things like my calendar that lists meetings scheduled for all clients. I have a list of companies that I can edit. I can add new companies or just drill into each one. I also have a full list of contacts. It's very similar to the company list. And finally, I have my deals where I can see at a glance where they are in the workflow or even push them along to the next phase if necessary. Okay, so that's a demo of what we're building, but before I get into the actual development, I want you to keep one thing in mind. I'll be building a lot of different components and tying them all together in a custom CRM using low code. I'm not trying to show you how to build the perfect CRM. Rather, I'm trying to show off what's possible with low code and how easily you can create different features and components and then tie them all together into your own custom CRM. Sound good? Okay, let's start the development. I'll be using the Empower Development Platform today, which is a low-code tool that's used to build really any type of business application over your data quickly, while still giving you full control over customization. Okay, so let's dive right in. To start things off, I'd like to create this single contact page that I showed you right here. And we'll be linking to this page from a few different places, so that's why I want to create it first. I'll just need to name this application and choose a template. I'll choose a single row template as it will only display one database row at a time. Now, I need to select my data, and I'll be using the contacts database table in this one, and we'll need all of the fields. Now, one thing, this doesn't include the company name, and I'd like to include it. So I'll join out to the company table and grab that name field. Okay, now I'll just need to tell Empower how to sort this data, and let's sort it by contact ID. Okay, that's all I need to do for this one, so let's build it. We'll still need to customize the look and feel of this after it's built, but Empower is doing the heavy lifting for us. And one thing to note, the build process that you just saw is the same build process I'll use for every application in this project. And of course, this is a basic application and I could do a lot more, but it's the same general process every time. You choose a template, select your data, build, and then customize however you want. Okay, so now that it's built, let's check it out. Obviously, it's just displaying data right now, but we'll need to make some changes to make it look like the one that I showed you before. So let's jump into MPainter and do that now. Empower's applications are built using N-tier architecture, which separates the data layer, the logic layer, and the front end. That means I can manage each layer independently of the other one. In this case, I can customize the front end here in MPainter. And while I've been talking, I've started working on this. I've just cleared out the contents that were in there and have split this row into two columns. Now, I need to add a card for the contact information, and I can do that easily right here. There's a lot of options, but I want this one. Okay, let's add the contact image, which I just need to tell MPainter where all of my images are, and then append the database field that has the contact's image file name. And now, because I'm removing the placeholder and adding a database-driven image, I won't see an image in MPainter anymore, but don't worry, it will appear when I run it. Okay, we're all set with the image. Now, MPainter gives me a list of all fields in this application over here. So now, it's just a matter of putting the fields in the right place. I'll just add the first name, let's see, the last name, and then remove this placeholder info. I'll do the same for the title, right here, and I'll also pull in the company name for this contact. Finally, I don't need these icons, so I'll just delete them. Now I just need to add the fields down here, but I'll speed through the video as it's pretty straightforward, and you've already seen me add a few fields already, so you understand the process. Okay, so that part is done. Let's check out what we have so far. All right, it's looking good. I have the contact box done, and it looks pretty good. Let's compare it to the demo to see what else we need to do. As you can see, we do still need to add the notes and the calendar over here, but first I want to focus on adding a way to edit or delete each contact. Now to do that, I need to create another application. The contact application I just made only displays data from our contacts database table, but I need a way to be able to edit the data in that table. And as I've been talking, I've started creating an application that will let me maintain the data in that table. And I'm not walking you through the process because it's the same thing as the first app, only using a different template. This application will let me create, add, update, or delete data in that contacts table. And as you'll see in a bit, I can easily make these two applications work together. And that's one of the really nice things about Empower. It takes a building block approach so the different applications you build can be combined to make even better applications. Okay, so this is done building, but I won't run it yet. I'll just go straight into MPainter and make some changes. So here's my form, and there's quite a bit I can do. First, I'll just hide this sequence field as I don't want that appearing in the form because that's created automatically. Next, I'll switch into layout mode so I can pretty up this form a bit. Now this lets me split columns and drag and drop my form fields to where I want them. I'll skip through this as it's pretty straightforward. Okay, just a couple more things. First, I want to change this to a text input. Next, I have this company ID field, but I don't want users manually typing in the company ID, so instead, I'll turn it into a drop-down list. To make one, Empower needs to know where the data is coming from. In this case, I want to create a data model that I can use as a drop-down list. Data models are reusable data sets that I'll be using a lot in this project, and one thing you'll notice is that creating one is very similar to creating an application. I need to select and sort my data, which in this data model, I just need the company ID field and the company name. Because I'm using this data for a dropdown, I need to set the company ID as the value and the name as a description. And that way, users can select the correct ID by just clicking on the company name. Now, I just need to add the finishing touches to this dropdown and I'm all set. I'll just wrap up the data model process and then configure my dropdown list. I'll quickly change the blank option text to something a little more descriptive, and I'm all done. I do also need to add a drop-down list to the lead origin field, but this time I'll use a quick list. A quick list is a good choice if you have a few items to select from, but don't have those records in a database table. I'll just quickly add a few items for my drop-down list, and one really nice thing about these quick lists is the fact that they're reusable. So once I make this, I can use it anywhere and maintain it in one place. Okay, so this one is ready. I'll finish it up and we should be good to go. Alright, let's save and run this. It looks good. You see that my company drop-down list works well. It's pulling all the companies from that database table, and the lead origin drop-down is working. Now, one thing I forgot. I have this avatar field where I can add the contact's image, but there's no way for users to upload an image. Let's change that. To do that, I need to go into Empower and edit the field settings. I'm basically telling Empower to treat this field as an upload field. And of course, once I do that, I need to specify where the files should get uploaded. Once that's done, I just need to rebuild this application, but not overwrite the changes I made in MPainter. So now, when I run this application, you'll see that I have an upload feature. Perfect. So, this form is now ready to go. Now I just need to add it to the contact page. Let's go back to Empower and add those buttons. I'll just need to jump into MPainter here and do that. Now I want to add an edit and a delete button right under the blue head section here. I'll just open up the component selector and grab this button option. Okay, let's change the button text to edit contact and then add a smart link. I'll link to that form I just created and smart link them together using the contact ID field.
And I want to show you a quick diagram of what's happening here because I'll do it a lot and it's not super obvious. Basically, I'm connecting this Contact View app with the Contact Maintainer app by passing the Contact ID field, which exists in both applications. In this case, the Contact ID is 102. So the Contact Maintainer looks up Contact ID field 102 in its data table and returns the corresponding record or records if there's a lot of them. Okay? So in Empower, we call that a smart link, and it's very useful in passing data between two applications, and I'm going to be doing this a lot. So that's what's going on in the background here.
Okay, getting back, Empower's smart enough to link these two applications on the contact ID field, since that's shared by both. I also want to click this option to put this form into update-only mode, so we'll only be able to update an existing record, but not add or delete records, and that makes sense here, because this is an edit button. Next, I'll move on to the last step, which are my link options. I want this form to be a pop-up dialog, which keeps the user on the contact page. I don't want them going to a different page to do this. I just need to adjust a few options here, and then tell Empower what to do when this form is submitted, which in this case, I want it to refresh the page. Okay, I'm done with the edit button, but before we check it out, let me quickly add the delete button. I'll do that right underneath and I'll make sure it's centered here. Now I won't make this a button per se, I'll just keep it as a text to link because I don't want someone accidentally clicking this when they're trying to edit. Now I'll go through the same process as you saw before. I'll link to that form and then I need to click this button to make sure that this time it can only delete a record and I don't want it
adding or editing, obviously, since it's a delete button. Now, I'll speed through the final options here since you've already seen them before and don't need to see them again. Okay, I think we're good. Let's save this and run the application. I now have my two buttons here, my edit button, which is working well, and my delete button. They both open in a pop-up like I want, so I think we're set here and ready to move on to the next part. Let's take a quick look at the demo application to see how we're doing. Okay, so we have the left side done. Now we just need to add the contact notes and the meeting calendar. I'll jump back into MPainter here and get working in that notes section. To do that, I'll add a data list right here. And right now it's a static data list, but let's connect it to a data table. I'm going to use a data model again, and this time I'll build over the contacts notes table. This table contains all of the notes for every contact in our CRM, and most importantly, it has that contact ID field. So I'll be able to smart link this notes table to my contacts page so it will only display notes for that one contact. Make sense? Okay, we have this table connected to a data model. Now if you look over in our fields list, the contact notes fields are available to use. I just need to add them to my table here. I'll add the note ID field, which is going to be hidden. I'll then add the date, the note author, and the note itself. Finally, I just need to add some table headings here, so I'll add that date, the author, and the note. Okay, so this is looking good. So now that that's done, let's check it out. Great, I have my notes in here for this contact. So the data list is working well. Now, of course, I need a way to add, edit, or delete a note. So I'll do the same thing I did before. I'll build a maintainer application over that same contact notes table. And once I do that, I'll be able to add buttons on that table to edit, delete, or add data. And I didn't walk you through that process as you've already seen it, but I hope you're noticing how easy it is to build applications and connect them together with MPower. And as you'll continue to see, that really lets you build some heavy-duty applications just like the CRM system. Okay, now that this is done, I'll open up that contact page again and jump back into MPainter. I need to add buttons to this data list so I can edit or delete each one or add new notes. First though, I want to wrap this whole table in a card. I think it'll look better and it gives me a place to add a title and the button that I'm going to need to add new notes. I'll replace this dummy text up here with a card title, let's say contact notes. Then I'll come over here and remove this dummy text and open up the component selector and grab this blue button. I won't add the link just yet, but I will add the correct button text in here. I also don't need this card footer, so let's just remove it. Okay, now I'll need to add a couple of columns for my edit and delete buttons, which is pretty easy. Okay, once I have those, I'll add a heading on each one up here. And now let's add those buttons. I'll grab this light one for editing and I'll use a red one for deleting. Finally, I'll replace the button text on each to edit note and delete note. Okay, now it's time to smart link them to that app I just made. So I'll link it up to that app I just made and then choose this option to only let this button update a record. I'll just finish it up with these options here, and then we'll do the same process for the delete and add buttons, but I'll going to do that in the background and skip ahead since it's identical to this process. Okay, so I added those links to the buttons and just want to do a couple of things before testing it. These columns for edit and delete are too large, and I'll never need them to expand because I know how large the buttons are. So MPainter lets me add CSS classes or styles if I want. I'm adding a style to each to make these columns have a width of exactly 100 pixels. Okay, we're all set here. Let's save it and check it out. It's looking good, but let's test things. First, I'll edit this note and just make a small change. And that shows up, so good. Now, I'll add a note. I'll pick a date, write the note's author, add the note. Once that's accepted, you can see that it shows up in my list. So that's working well. Now we just need to make sure I can delete it.
And once I delete this note, it seems to disappear so that everything's working as it should. And looks like we're all set to move on to the next step, which is the meeting calendar. And if you remember from this demo application, this calendar will serve a couple of purposes. First, I'll have it right here on the contact page to display meetings for each contact. But I'll also have it up here to display meetings for all contacts. So that's what we're going to build. To do that, I need to go back into Empower and create a new maintainer. I'll call this meeting calendar, and then I'll choose the calendar template. I have all of my meeting data in a table called event calendar. So let's grab all of the fields from that. Now, I also need fields from other tables. I need the company ID and name fields from the contacts table. I'll need the company name from the companies table. And I'll get the salesperson name from the salesperson table. And as you can see, Empower makes joining your tables together really simple. Now, I'll just sort it by event ID and move on. One thing we need to do before I build is tell Empower which fields to find the dates and times, which is obviously very important if I'm making a calendar application. I can also set the formatting for each field, and I'll quickly run through that. And this is the only template where I need to add this extra information before building, but I'm sure you can see why. Now, I'll speed up the video through this build phase since you've already seen it a few times and this video is getting kind of long. Okay, now that it's built, let's jump into MPainter first and make some changes. First off, I'm just going to hide these filters so I can see the calendar portion. Okay, now we see the calendar and it's showing us what data will display for each event. And that's more data than I want to show. So I want to delete all of these fields and start with a blank slate. Okay, now I can grab the fields that I want, and I want to start by showing what type of event this is. Is it a phone call, a meeting, or a video conference? Then I want to list which salesperson is in this meeting and with whom they are meeting with. So I'll grab the first and last name fields. And finally, I want an event description to tell us what this is about. All right. Now let's save this and check it out. It's looking good. I have some events displaying and they're showing the data that I want. If I click on one, I can see more data for that event and even update or delete the meeting. But this form isn't very well organized, so let's fix that. Going back to MPainter, I'll choose the web form option. Here I can edit the form and I'll switch it to layout mode so I can change the formatting. In this mode, I can add or delete rows, split rows, and drag my fields to where I want them. I'm going to do this in the background though and skip ahead because it's pretty self-explanatory. Okay, I now have my form organized how I want it. There are a few things I still need to do to make it better though. First, I want to turn this company field into a drop-down list so my users can select a company and not just type it in. I'll use that same data model I used last time and set this up. Now, the contacts field is a little different. I have over 1,500 contacts in here, and I don't want to scroll through the whole list just to find one. Instead, I'll make this a cascading drop-down list, which means it will only display the contacts in the company that I selected up above. Now, as you can see, I'm creating a data model for my contacts while I'm talking, and I know this process is probably repetitive by now, as you've seen it a couple of times already. But I'm showing you this because I'm going to do one thing differently. I'm creating a calculated field. You see, I want to display the full name in the dropdown, but I don't have a field for that. So I'm making a calculated field that will combine the first name and the last name to give me a full name. And then I can use that in my application, or in this case, I can use it in my dropdown. So now, if I go back into my field settings, I can select my contact ID as a list value, and then I have my new calculated field for full name, which I can select as a list description. Then it's just a matter of finalizing this data model and finishing up my cascading dropdown list. Okay, that cascading dropdown is done, And now I just need to do a couple more dropdowns, one for salespeople and one for event type. I won't show you those, as it's the same process as you've just seen, so I'll do that in the background and skip ahead. All right, so that's done, though actually I did one thing different for that event type. I made it a button list rather than a dropdown, and that's just a matter of selecting this option here. I think it'll work better for this form. Okay, I want to show you one more thing. You see that I have fields for phone number, event link, and location, right? These all depend on the event type. So if it's a phone meeting, we wouldn't need the event link or the location fields. So I'll add conditional rendering to only show the field that I need to show for that event type. So in this case, I'll only show this field if the event type equals phone call. Moving along, suppose the event is a video conference, like a Zoom meeting. Then I'd want to display this field for the meeting link. And finally, suppose it's an in-person meeting. I'll set it up to display this field for the location. After I have those set up, you'll notice there's a little red indicator here to tell you that they're conditional fields. Okay, I think we're done with this. Let me save and run the calendar again. To test our form, let me try to add an event here. The form looks much better now. Suppose I want to create a meeting with someone from, say, this company. Once I select that, the conditional drop-down list will only display contacts from that company here. Now, I need to select a salesperson that's going to have this meeting. And next, you see these buttons that I added to make it really easy to choose an event type. So suppose I wanted a video conference. Once selected, I now get that conditional field for that video link. Or suppose it's a phone call or an in-person meeting, then I'd get those fields. So that's working well. Let's make this one a phone call. Moving on, you see that I have a nice date picker in here in case I wanted to change that. And finally, I can adjust the start and end times right in here. I'll add the phone number for our call and then write a quick description. It now appears in my calendar as an event, and I can open it up to see more details or to update or delete it. Okay, so that's done. Now let's add this calendar to the contact page. I'll just close out a few of these tabs up here first and then open up that contact page app and jump back into MPainter. So now it's just a matter of importing that application I just created. And it's being smart linked to the contact ID field, so only see meetings for this one contact. Finally, I can choose how much of the application to import, and I'll just grab the static table, which in this case is the calendar. Okay, now that I have that in there, let's save it and run it. All right, it's looking good, but I do want to make one more change. I'd like to wrap this calendar in a card. I think it'll look better, and then I'll have a spot to put a heading. So right here, I'll change this text to meeting calendar 4, and then go and grab those two name fields, the first name and the last name. Now when I run it, I have my heading on there, and I think this is looking good. So I think this page is pretty much done. We've done quite a bit so far. We have the contact information here on the left. We can edit or delete that information as well. We can even manage notes or meetings for our contacts. And how long did all that take? 30 minutes or so? That's not bad considering all that we've done. Now, let's move on to the next part, which is the company page.
Looking at the company page demo here, let's check out what we're building. This page holds all of our company info and looks similar to the contact page on the left here, but has some pretty significant changes on the right. We have these tabs with notes, deals, and contacts for this company. And then up at the top, we have a snapshot view of their revenue and contracts. I'm going to walk you through the process of building everything on the right here, but I'm going to build this app and format the data for the left side in the background and then skip the video ahead since it's the exact same process as you saw for the contacts page, but over a different database table. So I'll go ahead and create that in the background and then skip the video ahead once that's done. There, I'm all done with the left side of this company page. It's very similar to the contact page, as you can see, but with the company data. I even have buttons to edit or delete companies in here. Okay, now let's build the right side. But before I do that, let me quickly open up the demo page again just to show you what I'll be building. I'm going to start with this tab section here where I have notes, deals, and contacts. Sound good? Okay, let's get started. I'll open up MPainter for that company page app, and the first thing I want to do is add those tabs. As you can see, I have a lot of options, but I'm looking for tabs with icons, so I'll grab these ones right here. If you remember from the app, I need 3 tabs, so let's quickly add another one. I do need to add an icon to this one, which is pretty easy. Now, this is going to be for my contacts, so let's do a user icon. Then, I just need to change this heading to contacts. Let's go ahead and update all of our tab headings here. I'll change this one to deals and then swap this icon with a different one, maybe a dollar sign. Finally, this tab will have my notes in it, so I'll update this icon to say an edit icon. Okay, now let's add our notes. If you remember the contact page, I displayed notes as a data list in table format, but let's do this a little differently. I want to display notes in a card format. Once I have my card in there, I'll turn it into a data list, which, if you remember from before, a data list will retrieve rows from a database and render them on the selected element, which in this case is a card. And while I'm talking, I'm setting up another data model to get those notes, but I'm not walking you through it as you've seen this process 4 or 5 times already. Now, this will be smart linked to the company ID field, so it will only display notes for the selected company. Okay. Now I just need to grab the fields from my newly created data model and arrange them in this card. So I want the date and mention who the note was written by, and then grab the author. And finally, let's insert the note itself. Okay, so we're pretty much done here. I'll save this and check it out. It looks like the notes are working well, but I do need to add a little spacing in between them, so I'll go back into MPainter here and do that. I'll open the styling overrides and add a top margin here. This will add a margin to the top of every card in this data list. Okay, that's done, so let's save this again and take a look. It's looking much better now. To wrap this notes section up, I'll just need to add buttons to add, delete, or update each note. And if you remember from the contact page notes, I used a maintainer application for those buttons. And now I built that maintainer application for these notes in the background, since you've already seen me do that for the contacts page, and it's exactly the same process. So now I'll just add the buttons that I need in here and then go through and hook them up to that application I made. So this button will be for deleting the note. So I'm going to delete all of this text in here. And let's add an icon, let's find an X here for remove. Perfect. Okay, so now I need to add some space up above this note, so I'm going to add content before. All right, now that I have my space in there to add a button, I will grab this blue one, and let's change the text to add note. And finally, I need a way to edit a note, so I'm going to put a button, let's say with an icon, right next to this note. I just need to delete what's in there now, and let's just keep it as an icon. All right, so let's add an edit icon in there, and now I have all the buttons that I need for my notes. So now I just need to connect this button to the note ID field, so that way when I'm editing the note, it knows exactly which note I'm selecting. And I'm going to go through and connect the final two buttons in the background just because it's the same process. I don't want this to get too repetitive and show you the exact same thing over and over. So I'll do that now and skip ahead. Okay, so we're all done. Let's save it and check it out. This is looking good now. I have my buttons. Why don't we see if they're working in here? So I'll add a note. Let's say it's from Steve. Let's just add a test note in here. And save that. So perfect, now that note appears in this list. If I delete that note, it will disappear. Perfect. So I think we're all set with the notes section here, so now we can move on to the deals. And if you remember from the demo page, the deals section looks a little different.
It has this edit and delete option so I can manage each deal, but I also have status badges and buttons to move a deal from one stage to the next. Also, if you remember, I have this deals table here, which keeps track of all deals for all customers. And that's what we're going to build right now. Now, I'm going to do this a little differently, maybe a little backwards. I'm building the form to maintain those deals first, and then I'll build the table to display all of the deals, and you'll see why in a little bit. So right now, I'm just going through the process of building that form that I'm going to use to maintain all of my deals. And I'm not walking you through each step because you've seen all these steps before, and there's really nothing different about this build process as opposed to any of the others you've seen. So I'm just going to click build here and let Empower do all the work. Actually, I'm going to fast forward the video ahead so you're not just stuck waiting for it to build. And now that it's built, let's jump into MPainter here. Now the first thing I want to do is arrange this form a little differently. And I'm going to speed the video up through this because it's just dragging and dropping, and you've seen all that before. Now, I need to add a few drop-downs, so I'm going to change this heading here, and I'm going to add that company list drop-down that you've seen a few times now. And actually, I'm going to add all these different drop-downs in the background because it's a process that you've seen so many different times, and there's no sense repeating it over and over and over. Okay, so I added those drop-downs in the background. Now, let's save it and check it out. Okay, so it looks pretty good. I have my drop-downs in there. I can select the date, I can select my salesperson for each deal, and the deal status. So that's perfect. Now, I'm going to show you something a little different. I'm going to go back to the application and jump into the workflow designer. And I'm going to use this area more later on to set up my workflow automation. But first, I am going to go to statuses and set up some status options. And these status options, the best way to describe them are they're stages that a deal can be in. So once I have these different stages set up, then I can use them in different places. I can use them within my workflow. So when a deal moves from one stage to the next, I can trigger it to do something. I can also set up status badges, so I can display those in my deal app like you've seen. And I'm only setting up three different statuses. So in this fictional company, a deal can be in one of three states. It can be, we could have sent the contract to a potential prospect. That prospect then could have signed the contract and returned it. And finally, that prospect becomes a customer when they pay the invoice. So those are my three statuses. And now I need to set up my status transitions that basically tell Empower how these different deal stages progress. So once I do that, then I can have that nice little button in that deal list where I can click it and move it to the next stage. So now I'm just telling Empower that a deal can go from contract sent to contract signed and then to invoice paid. I can't go straight from contract sent to invoice paid. That makes sense? Okay, so I have those statuses all set up now. Now we can move on and build that deals table. So I'm going to create a new retrieval here. Let's call it deals list. And I'm going to choose a multiple row data list here. So, and once again, this is the same build process as you've seen quite a few times already. I'm just grabbing my data. I have to join out to the company's table to grab that company name. And finally, I just need to sort my data. So I'm going to click build, but skip ahead until it is finished building. And then we're going to jump into MPainter and edit this. The first thing to do is remove a few of these columns. I don't need that to display in my table. I don't need this one. I don't need this email one. And finally, I just want to drag and drop some of these fields around to put them in a different order. So let's put the company over here. I've got to put the deal status before that. And then, oops, I missed one to delete. I don't need this sales ID in here. Okay, so now I need a couple more columns, one before deal status and one after. And this first one, that will be the column that I put my edit and delete buttons in. And this one over here, this will be that button where I can update the status, where, as you saw, I can move it from one stage to the next. So this deal status, I'm going to delete this and just grab a badge. This is all because I set up those status badges in that maintainer application. So I'd have to select which maintainer I'm using, and I'm going to pull in a status badge. So this will just pull whatever status badge that deal has. I'm going to do the same with the button list. And this button list allows me to click a button and move a deal from one stage to the next. And finally, I am going to add a button group, which is a little new. This is just a combination of more than one button. And I only need two here, so I'll get rid of this one. And this will just be for editing and deleting each of my deals. And I'm actually going to skip ahead because you've seen this process so many times. So I'm going to skip ahead and do that in the background. Okay, so I'm all done with those buttons. Now I think we are ready to test it out. Let's run this. And as you can see, it looks a lot like it did in the demo. Just one thing though, I want to make these columns a little smaller, especially the edit and delete columns. And I'm doing that because I know this column size will never change, and I want to give room for the rest of the data. So I'm going to do that to the edit and delete column and also for the status badge column. And now let's run that and check it out. Okay, I think it's looking a lot better. So now you can see that I can edit a deal and I get that nice form. I can go and delete a deal if I wanted to. I won't do it. And I can also click this button and move a status to the next phase. So if I click this button right here, I move my deal from the contract sent stage to the contract sign stage. And if I click it again, I said the invoice has been paid, and now I can't do anything else to this because that's the final stage of a deal. Okay, so now we are ready to add this to our company page. So let's go back into Empower and open up that company page. And then we'll just jump right back into MPainter here. So let's go to that Deals tab, remove that dummy text that's there, and go over to Import Content from Another App. And of course, we are going to go and grab that Deals app that I just made. Let's grab that and connect it on the company ID field. So this will only display deals for this specific company. Finally, once I get my static data table, I should be good to go. So let's run this. And now you see that it's looking good. I can edit a deal. I can change the status of a deal. Let's say we got an invoice paid. I can update this one. And I think we're all set here. So this is looking good. Now we can finally move on to the last tab of here, which is we'll add all of our contacts for the specific company. Okay, to do that, we need to jump back into MPainter here, and I'll click on this Contacts tab and remove this text in here. So I'm going to display these contacts as cards, so I'm going to grab this one. And if you remember from before, to display my contact data as a card, I need to turn this card into a data list. So I'm going to grab this contact list data model and connect them or smart link them on the company ID field. And of course, that means that only contacts from this specific company will appear on this page. Now we just need to go through and add the correct fields within this card. And I'm going to first start with the image, so the contact's face. Actually, I'm not going to do it this way. I'm just going to show you one cool feature about Empower that I haven't shown you. And that's you can edit the HTML directly if you want. So I'm going to go in here and put the path to that image in here. I don't have to do that. I could do it through the interface, but I just wanted to show you that's a possibility. Now let's just go through and add those fields for our contacts. Let's grab the full name field. We're going to grab the title. Let's delete this badge here and put the, what do we want in here? The email address. And finally, let's put the phone number right down here and then delete the rest of this text. And actually, we're going to have to change this icon. So let's change this icon to how about a phone? And if we have it there, we should put an icon in front of the email. So let's put an icon. Let's grab the envelope and then just maybe add a couple spaces in here. And we should be good to go. So let's save this and check it out. So good. It's pulling all my contact data, but it's not really formatted in the way I want to format it. So let's go back into MPainter and fix that. So to format it, I need to go into Styling Overrides in here and then make sure I have the data list selected. And let's add a style in here. I only want these cards to extend to just under half of the width. So let's say this should be 48%. Then let's add some margins so they're not just, so all the cards aren't just butting right up against each other. And finally, let's make them all float so that way they can have more than one card on one line. So let's save that and run it. It's looking good now. I have all my contacts for this company, and there's just one more thing to do. I want to be able to click on the contact name and go straight to their contact page. So if you remember from before, that means we just need to add a smart link to this full name calculated field here. And I am going to link it to the contact ID. So I'm linking to the contact page and smart linking to the contact ID so it knows which page to go to. So let's save that and run it again. And now let's click on one of these contacts and we go straight to their page. Now I hope you're seeing how easily you can connect everything together. And we're going to be doing more of that in a little bit. But once I have these different applications built, I can easily just connect them all together so it works as one cohesive unit. All right, let's go ahead and finish up this page. If you remember back from the demo company page, I have these nice little statistics up here that gives an at-a-glance view of really the important data for each company, like revenue, unpaid invoices, and unsigned contracts. So let's go ahead and add that now. It's real easy. First, I need to split this row up into three different columns. And then it's just a matter of adding stat widgets. And the stat widgets we haven't covered yet, but they're just like cards and tabs. I just need to grab one of these options in here, and there's a lot of them. So let's take this green one. And then I'm gonna go through and add stat widgets for each section here, and then connect it to the backend data after I have them all in there. So let's wrap this up by grabbing this white one up here. And now I can go through and connect each one to the correct data. Okay, to do that, I just need to first delete this dummy data. And then I'm going to go over here and add insert tools and percentages. Now this data model is the exact same thing you've seen before, but it has one key difference. With this, I only want to total the value of paid contracts for this company. And I can do that by adding a filter. And as you might expect, a filter lets me tell the data model to only grab data if it matches a specific criteria, which in this case, I'm only grabbing data for this company if the deal status equals invoice paid. And finally, I need to tell it which field to use as the value, and that's going to be this total field here. So in short, this data model is going to add up the total value of all of this company's deals, but only if the deal status equals invoice paid. Now, of course, I want to change this from total clicks to something more descriptive like total revenue. And that makes sense because that's the amount of money we have received from this customer. Now I want to change the icon. Let's grab this line chart. And I'm going to go through and do the same exact thing to these two other stat widgets, but I'm not going to show you because it's the same process. The only difference is I'm creating data models that are looking at different deal statuses. For instance, this one I'm creating now is only looking for a deal status of contract signed. That tells me that the contract is signed, but the invoice is not paid, and I'm just going to total up that. I'm going to do these two in the background here and skip the video ahead. Okay, so we're all done with that. I added those totals. Let's save this and run it. So now you see I have those stat widgets in there that are telling me the total revenue, the value of unpaid invoices, and the value of unsigned contracts. If I were to add up all these totals in the deals, you'd see that it equals whatever's up here. So this company page is nearly done. There's a couple more finishing touches I need to come back to, but for the most part, we're all set. Now, we can finally move on to building that home page. So let's take a look at that demo application again so we can see what the home page looks like. As you see, I have these three stat widgets up here. I have these two nice charts here that tell me revenue by lead, origin, and deals by month. And then I have my contacts, companies, and deals in tabs at the bottom. So there's a lot of pieces that go into this. It's not that difficult to build though. So let's just dive right in and get started. First thing I want to do is go into Empower and create a new retrieval. And I'm going to call this homepage. And I'm going to get this single row data list right here. Now I'm going to get data from CRM contacts, but you know, it doesn't really matter what data fields I'm going to grab for this one, because when I get into MPainter, I'm just going to clear all the contents and start importing applications and putting in data lists and stat widgets. So the data I'm putting in here right now doesn't really matter. So I'm going to skip ahead to the end of this build process because you've seen it so many times and just get right into MPainter. First thing I want to do is clear the contents. And then I want to set up my layout. So I'm going to go into layout mode and add two rows underneath this row. I'm going to split this into three columns, this one into two columns, and that one will stay one. Now, I'll just go through and add my stat widgets real fast. And with these stat widgets, I'm doing the same thing that you saw me do on the company page. Only difference is I put two red ones in there. I want to go into styling overrides and change this to green. Okay, so now I'm just going to do the exact same process as I did for the company page. I'm using the same data models. So this stat widget will display total revenue based on invoices paid. And the only difference here is I am not smart linking it to any company ID. Rather, this stat widget is going to show me all revenue for all companies in my CRM. Okay. So I'm going to skip ahead to the end and do these two other stat widgets in the background because you've already seen this process. Now that it's done, let's save that and run it. And there we have it. I have these three stat widgets that display data for all companies in my CRM. Now, if you open up the demo page, I'm going to be creating these two graphs right here. So to do that, this isn't a process that you've seen yet. We're going to go to the reports section of Empower and create a new report. And I'm going to call this revenue by lead origin and choose the report designer. And this is the same general build process as you've seen. There will be some differences. Here though, I'm just picking the data that I want to use in this chart. And then I just need to sort it like normal. The only difference is I'm telling Empower that the lead origin field can be subtotaled because I want to use that subtotal data in my chart. I'm pretty much done with this. I'm going to jump into the report designer real fast and change this to a chart layout. I can do a lot in this report designer. I can change the report type. I can only grab the chart, which is what I'm doing. And now I'm just going through and adjusting some settings for my chart to make sure it's exactly how I want. And then I just need to build it. And I'm going to skip this build process ahead again because it's the same build process for everything and you've seen it so many times. So there, we're done. We have our chart ready to go and that's ready to be imported into our homepage. But before I do that, I want to go and build that other chart first. So I'm going to go through the same process again. I'm going to name this deals by month, choose the report designer once again. And keep in mind, I don't have to use the report designer. We have other report types like pivot tables, interactive reports, ranking reports. I'm just choosing this because I only want to grab the charts out of this. But Empower is a pretty powerful reporting tool on its own. And as you can see, the process is the same, but there are going to be some big differences. Right now I'm adding a filter because I only want this chart to display data that is in this year. Otherwise, it will total up all my months across every year, and I only want to see this one. Now, I have a small issue here because I want to display the month name in the chart, but I don't have a month name field.
my date field is just a standard date format. So I'm going to create a calculated field to display that month name. The problem is, while I have a lot of functions in here, I don't have a function to get the month name. And one of the great things about MPower is it's very open. It uses standard languages, so I can use any SQL function in here. A simple search tells me that I can use this month name function and just copy it into my calculations. Again, that's the great thing about MPower. It uses technologies and languages that you're already using. It's not forcing you to use a proprietary language or do things a proprietary way. I can use standard SQL functions within MPower. And now I also need to get the month number because I want to sort this report by month. But if I sort it alphabetically, I'm going to have April 1st, and that's not going to work. So I'm going to go out and grab that month number function. So this will just return the number of the month from this date field. So if it's January, it'll be 1, February will be 2, and so on. So because of that, I can then go back into my dimensions over here and go to available fields and use this new calculated field as my sorting field. So I'm going to sort it by month number, so it'll be January, February, March, and so on, rather than sorting it by order ID or month name, because that wouldn't make sense for this chart. Okay, so I'm all done. Let's build this. And I'm going to skip the build process ahead and just run this report. And I'm running this just to show you what it looks like out of the box, and then to show you how easily I can change it. So I have all my data in there, but I can go back into the report designer and then only display it as a chart. And I want to get this bar chart. I'm going to then go through and do my chart fields, tell it what dimension to use as my chart level, and then make a quick change in here to make sure this chart spans the width of whatever container it's in. So I'm going to go back and rebuild this because I made a few changes. I'm going to skip through that build again and run it. So now you see that I have my chart and it's displaying my deals by month. And I hope you're seeing how easily I can create reports and then change how I see the data through this report designer tool that MPower has. And I'm only scratching the surface here, but you can create any type of report. You can create dashboards, BI apps. Really any reporting type application with MPower's reporting tools. I'm just using it to show you something very simple, and that is to build some graphs. And now I just need to get back into MPainter and import those graphs into my home page. And I don't need to map any fields because this isn't for any specific company. Now let's go back and add that deals by month. And then I should be good to go with this. So let's save and run. And now you see that my graphs show up in there. Now they don't look very good just sitting off by themselves like that, but now I want to go back into MPainter and quickly wrap them each in a card. And I think that this will look a little better, and it gives me a way to add a title to each one. Let's make this deals by lead origin, and let's wrap this one in a card. Let's grab that same default card, and then let's change this to revenue by month. Okay, so that should be good. Let's save that and run it. And now it does look a little better. That deals by lead origin graph, I do want it to be centered. So let's go back into MPainter and center that. So I go over to style overrides. Let's click center, run this, and now it looks good. So just a few minutes, I've added these nice little charts that tell me important data about the companies in my CRM. And now, if we take a look at the demo page again, we're ready to move on to this tab section that has contacts, companies, and deals. And to do that, I need to build two applications. And these are just applications that are going to list out my companies and deals. Now, I already have an app that lists out my deals, which I'm using in the company page, so I can just reuse that here. But I do need to build two applications, one that lists out my companies and one that lists out my contacts. So to do that, I'm going to go and build a new retrieval. And I'm only going to show you the first one. I'm going to show you how to build a company list, and then I'm going to do the contact list in the background because it's the exact same process, only over a different table.
And again, you've seen this process by now so many times, and I hope you're understanding just how easy Empower makes things, that every build process is the same, and therefore every build process is super fast. And once again, I've completed this build process, I've built it, and now I'm coming into MPainter and making a few adjustments. I want to delete a column, and then I want to add a smart link on this company name that will link out to the company page. So somebody can just click that, click each company, and drill down into their page. So I think we're set here. I'm going to save that and run it. And now that's looking good. So now I have my company list, and I'm going to do the exact same thing for the contact list, but I'm going to do that in the background and skip ahead. Okay, good. So that's done. I have my contact list, and you see I have a drill down on the contact name and the company name. So I can click each and drill into that specific contact or company, which is really useful. Now, we just need to add this to the home page. So I'm going to open up the home page again in MPainter. And then down here in this section, I'm going to add some tabs. And once again, I have a lot of tab options in here. I'm going to add those tabs with the icons next to them. So I'm going to grab these ones. And I do need to add another tab and put an icon next to it. So this is going to be for deals. So let's put a dollar sign. And let's add some spaces, and then let's write deals in here. And let's go through and quickly update these tab headings and icons. So I have companies, I'm going to add a building icon, and then contacts. Let's go in here and add a user icon. And now we're almost done. It's just about importing those applications that I just created. And that's one of the big strengths of Empower, is what I make is reusable. So I can use this contact list on its own. I can use it embedded in other applications. I can add those smart links that you saw, so I can drill down into other areas of my applications. It's a really powerful aspect of Empower, is that everything you make can be reused. You've seen that a lot with the data models, is once I make a data model, I use it all over the place. And now you're seeing it more with these applications. So this deals list, for example, I just embedded it into this home page, but I also use it in other places too. Now that we're done, let's save this and run it. And so, great. Now you see that this is looking like the demo homepage. I have my contacts here. I have my companies. And I can drill down into each company if I want to, straight from the homepage, and I have my deals. So this homepage is pretty much done. And how long did that take? Maybe 5-10 minutes or at the most. And I have these nice stat widgets up here that give me an at-a-glance view of my company's revenue and expected revenue. I have these nice charts in here that tell me where the money is coming from and how much we've made per month. And then I also have all my contacts, companies, and deals down here that I can drill down into and get more information if necessary. So going back to the demo app, there's only a couple more things I need to build, and it's these lists for companies and contacts. And you might be thinking, that's the same thing that I just made. However, the big difference with these are CRUD applications, which means I can create, read, update, or delete each record. So with this application, I can add new companies, I can edit existing companies, or I can just delete them. So I need to build that for the companies and the contacts. And what I'm going to do the same thing that I did before, where I'm just going to build one of them first and then do the other in the background. So I'm going to go to maintainers. Let's start by building this company page. So I'm going to name it Maintain Companies. And we want this data list with web form. That one displays all my data in a list, as you saw. It also gives me the ability to update, delete, or add new records as necessary. So I'm all done building this. And as you saw, it's the same process as all the others. I'm going to skip through that build phase. And I just need to go in here and make some changes. So I just need to delete a few of these table columns. I'm just going to speed through that because it's pretty self-explanatory. And then I'm going to add a smart link onto this company field. And we're going to link out to that company page again. But this time I need to smart link it to the company ID, so it knows which page to actually go to. And now I need to make some changes to this web form. And I think I'm just going to do this in the background and skip ahead because it's all stuff you've seen before where I'm adding those drop-down lists using the data models I've created earlier. I'm also going to be changing the layout of this form so it looks a little better. But again, you've seen this all before, so I don't want to have to keep repeating the same process over and over. So I'm going to skip ahead and then come back when this form is all done. Okay, so I finished up that form. Let's save this and run it. Now you see I have my data list, and if I click the form, my form looks a lot better now. I have all these dropdowns in here. It's laid out in a much nicer way. Now, I'm going to do the same exact thing for the contacts list, but I'm going to build that in the background because it's just the same process, and I'm going to skip ahead. Okay, so I'm done with the contact list. Now let's run it and see what it looks like. As you can see, it looks very similar to the company page. I have my form in here, not as many fields because this is only for the contacts, but I do have my smart links in here so I can drill down to various contacts and companies. And we're getting close to wrapping this up. One thing I do need to do is add these menu options up here where I can quickly navigate in between my different applications that I've made. So to do that, I need to go back into Empower and go to the admin section and click on menu and security. And I can really do a lot in here, like add security, add role-based security, add users, make people sign in. I can even set up row-based security where different users can see different data within the same application. I don't need to do any of that now. For now, though, I just need to set up these menu options. So I'm going to create a menu group, and I'm going to name that CRM options. And let's save that, and then let's go to menu options and add those options that you saw. And what I'm going to do is just show you how easily I can add an option, and it's just about going in and finding the applications I've already built, changing the names. I can add an icon, so let's say this one is for my calendar. So let's add that calendar icon. I have to put it into that group I just made and then say what user role it's for. And that's a nice thing is I can create a bunch of users, assign them to different roles. So each one will only see the applications that they're allowed to see within that menu. And I'm just going to add the rest of these options and skip ahead because it's the same process, but five different times. So now that we're done, let's go to our homepage and look at our menu. So let me refresh this real fast. And you can see that I have a nice menu in here now to navigate to my different applications within my CRM.
Okay, so I just want to do one more thing before I get onto the workflow piece. And that is, I need to add a nice breadcrumb trail up at the top of every page. And this is such an important step because it ties everything together so I can easily navigate in between the different pages within my CRM. So the first thing we need to do is open up this company page and then jump into MPainter. I'll need to add a row above all this content up here to put my breadcrumb trail in. And then I just need to type out what I want it to say. So let's do home, company page, and then the company name. And I'll add that company name field in here. So every time you click on a company page, it will display the correct name. And then it's just a matter of linking out to my different applications that I've already created. So this first one, I'd link out to that maintainer application that lets me maintain all of my companies. And I don't need to do any actions or map any fields. So let's move on and hit apply. Now I just need to link out to that home page. And again, this is such an important piece because it ties everything together so I can easily navigate in between the different areas within my CRM and it feels like one cohesive unit. So let's wrap this one up and let's save this and run it and see what it looks like. There, I have my breadcrumb trail. If I click this company page, I'm taken to my company list, which makes me realize that I misnamed this link right here. It should not say company page, it should say company list. So let's change that, save that, and run it again. Now I have my company list link. I am taken to this page where I can maintain all of my companies.
And now what I want to do is just go through in the background and add this breadcrumb trail to all the different applications, and then skip the video ahead when I'm done. Okay, so I'm all done. If I click on this contact page now, I have a nice breadcrumb trail here leading me right to each contact. So as you can see, this helps me really navigate nicely throughout the different pages within my CRM. This is looking pretty good now. I think we're finally ready to move on to that workflow piece. So to do that, we just need to go to the company page. So what we're going to do here is add a workflow piece onto this deals list here. So every time a new deal is added, it will trigger a workflow. And every time a deal status is updated, it will move to the next stage in that workflow. Sound good? All right, let's get started with that. The first thing that needs to happen when this company gets a new deal is they need the customer to sign a contract. And here's the contract we're working with. It's pretty basic, but without automation, an employee would have to come in and enter the information and then email it to the customer. And I just want that all to happen automatically. So to do that, I need to create an application that pulls data from my database tables and puts it into that PDF document that I just showed you. And as I'm talking, I'm creating this application. As you can see, it's the same process as you've seen before. So I'm not going to walk you through it. I'm just grabbing the fields that I need from the tables I need. The only difference when I'm done with this, and I'll just speed through this, is I'm going to have to map some properties to that PDF document when it's built. So now it's built, let's go into properties. And I first need to tell Empower where this document is. So I pasted the path. Then I just have to go through and map my database fields to the field names in the PDF document. And I will speed through this because it's pretty self-explanatory. All right, I'll save that. So when I run it, it generates a PDF for me with my fields mapped. Pretty handy, right? And that's the first step. Now I need to set up a task group, which is basically a series of events that I can trigger in my workflow, or I can schedule to run at specific times, like say for reports, data summaries, text messages, things like that. I'll create a task group, and now I need to add a task, which defines what will happen when this group is called. I'll give it a short description and choose this option down here to merge data to PDF and send via email. Then I'll move to the next step and tell it which application to run for this, which is my PDF merge application. I do need to map the order ID field to this PDF generator app so I can pass that data to it in my workflow. For the recipients, let's pull in the email field, and that should be good. Now I just need to fill out my email info, and this is what a new customer will see when they get their contract email. And of course, if this was an email that I'm using in my day-to-day business, I'd pretty it up a little bit. But for this one, I'm going to keep it simple. I just need to fill out a quick sender email, who it's coming from, and write up a quick subject. All right, I think we're all set. I think I'm ready to set up my customer onboarding workflow now. I'll open the application that's used to add new deals and dive into the workflow area of that. This workflow can be set to fire anytime this form performs an action, such as adding, updating, or removing a record. To start things off, I'll set a condition that will trigger when a new deal is added.
And when this new deal is added, it's going to start the entire workflow. The first step, though, is I need to send the contract to the customer. So I'm going to call that task group that I just created that sends the PDF contract to our new customer. And I have to map a couple fields, if you remember, because I used these in my task group. So the order ID and the deal email. And now that's done. So now we move on to step two of our workflow. And to do that, I need to set a condition. And this step is going to fire when the contract is signed. So I just need to change the status to contract signed. And what I want to do here when the contract is signed is send my new customer's information to my payment processor, which is Stripe. And to do that, I need to connect to Stripe's API. But I just remembered I don't have a web service set up to connect to this API yet. So let's do that now. And the great thing about Empower is I can connect to any REST API and then pull data from that service. Or in this instance, I want to post data to that service, which is Stripe. So to set things up, let me quickly
find Stripe's API reference documents. And I'm doing this just to show you how easily you can connect to an API. You just need to find the other service's URL that you post to. I've already set up an authentication method, which is my Stripe API key. And then I just need to tell Empower how this data is formatted, so what the response data is like, and then paste it in here. So Empower parses that and understands the data format for this particular API. All right, I have that all set up. So now we are ready to post data to Stripe. So I'm going to go back into my workflow, and we're going to call an external API. And let's call this Add Company to Stripe. I'll use that pre-configured web service that I just created. And then I need to update the content type because this is the data format that Stripe wants the data to be in. So what I'm doing now is matching the fields in Stripe with the fields that I want to send over. And I'm only sending over three: the order ID, the email, and the company name. All right, so that's done. Now we need our last condition, and that will fire when the invoice is paid. So once we get our invoice paid in Stripe, two things are going to happen. First, I want to post this new deal to my ERP system. And this is something that many companies might want to do. They have a CRM and an ERP, and you need them to communicate with each other and keep things updated. And so in this way, I can automatically add any new deals to my ERP system without having to do anything manually. So now I'm just mapping up the fields from this application to the app that writes to my ERP, and I'll just skip ahead because this is pretty self-explanatory and there's quite a few fields. Okay, so now that we're done, that's just the first action I want to take when the invoice is paid. The second one is I want to fire off an email to our salesperson who's in charge of that account to let them know that it's time to schedule service. So everything has been done. The contract has been signed, the invoice has been paid, and now we can finally set up a service time for this new customer. So one of the great things here is I can pull database fields into this email. So I want to pull in the company name, and we're also going to grab the email so the salesperson knows how to contact this new customer. All right, now we're all done. We have our customer onboarding workflow all set up. It's going to be triggered when a new deal is added, and when that happens, a PDF contract will get sent. When that is signed, the information gets pushed off to our payment processor to create an invoice and send that to the customer. And when that is paid, the new deal gets sent off to our ERP, and the salesperson in charge of that account is notified so they can set up service. Now that that's all set up, let's quickly test it to make sure everything is working. And I'm going to test it by adding a new deal to a company page and then walking you through what happens every time I update the status. But first, though, I want to find a company that doesn't have any deals yet just to make it a little easier to track. So let's start with this company. I'm going to start by adding a new deal and just filling out the form here with the date, with the hours for this contract, the hourly rate, and the deal total will be $5,000. Then I just need to paste in the email address that we want the contract to be sent to, and I created a dummy one just for this video so it's easy to test. Okay, so once I put that in there, now the deal's showing up in my page, which is perfect, and it's also being reflected in this first box here as it should. Now, let's go check that email. So if I open up Gmail, you see that I did receive an email, perfect, and I have a contract in here, and you see that all of my data has been pulled over, just like it should. So that's working as it should. Empower is taking the info from that new deal I added, merging it to a PDF, and then emailing it off to the customer, which is exactly what I want it to do. Going back to the company page, if I were to click this and say that the contract is now signed, it will get sent to my payment processor, Stripe. But before I do that, I want to open up my dashboard just to show you there's no customers in there yet. So let's go to the customers tab. That's empty. And now we can update that company page and say that we've received the contract and it's signed. And once I do that, it triggers the next step of our workflow, which sends my customer info to Stripe for invoicing. So let's refresh this page here. And there you go. We have our new customer in there. And for this demo, I'm just putting the information into Stripe. We could set it up where it automatically sends an invoice, or you could do other things. But for sake of simplicity and time, I'm just showing you how easily you can pass data from an Empower application to any other software with a REST API. Okay, so that's all done. Now let's suppose that we've received payment and we can move on to the final step of our customer onboarding process. So now it's marked as invoice paid. And if you remember from our workflow, updating that status should have done two things. First, it would have posted that deal to our ERP order table. And let's check that real fast. And you can see that it's in there. So I'm looking at my ERP order database table, and that new deal is there. So that's working well. Secondly, it should have sent an email off to our salesperson in charge of that account to let them know that everything is ready and it's time to set up service. And for sake of simplicity, I'm just using the same email address as before, just to show you that everything's working. And you can see that we've received that email that I wrote up before in the workflow process. And obviously, I could pretty this up a lot more. I'm just keeping it simple for sake of the demo. Okay, so that's it. Our workflow process is working great. If I were to refresh this page, you'll see that the total revenue is now updated to $5,000 because we've gone through the whole process. We've received money. The invoice has been paid. This customer is all set up in our system. So that's it. I've just put together a custom CRM system that includes workflow automation. It integrates with third-party invoicing systems. It updates an ERP system. It includes scheduling, reporting, and so much more. The best part is you're in total control. It's built to perfectly fit the business's needs. It can easily scale or be changed as needed. Also, you're in total control of the data. You can store it in-house or even in the cloud. And how long did all that take? Less than an hour and a half, and we've built a fully functional custom CRM system. That's probably less time than it would take to set up an out-of-the-box CRM system, and what we've just built is totally custom and can grow and change with your company. If you'd like to play around with this demo on your own, I've included a link below the video. If you'd like to learn more about Empower or set up a demo, visit us on the web at mrc-productivity.com. Thanks for watching.